Hello friends, this is Durga from IT Varsity. As part of this session, we will actually talk about some of the issues which people run into while setting up the Docker environment on Windows. And also I would suggest some of the recommendations. Those who are watching this on YouTube, this is in the data engineering workshop series for US graduates. And as part of the last session, I have suggested them to set up a Docker-based development environment. Some of the people have tried it on Windows and they ran into issues. So I just want to help them in providing alternatives if the issue cannot be addressed due to the limitations within Windows. That being said, those who have issues with Windows, can you guys unmute yourself and explain what the issue is? And then we will see if there is an easy solution for it. Some of the people are able to pass that issue. Some of the people could not. Most of the people could not because of the restrictions on Windows. So I will just try to understand what the issue is and then I'll take it further. Anyone in the call who have issues with respect to setting up Docker on Windows?
Yes, hi, this is Janik. And so I tried to install Docker on Windows, but it didn't work for me. I found one article on Medium that where I have to create a couple of batch files for the container and Hyper-V. So I tried doing that, but it is still not working for me and I'm still getting the same error that it's a version issue.
So what is the configuration of your machine?
Yeah, it's a 16-bit and Windows 10 home.
64-bit, right? 64-bit
yeah, yeah.
Windows 10?
Yes.
And how much memory you have?
16 GB.
Okay. i7 or i5?
i5.
Okay. So I would recommend you to set up a dual boot with Ubuntu as second operating system and then use Ubuntu to set up Docker. Over a period of time, you will see a lot of benefits because of that. Learning will be a bit faster if you start using Ubuntu. So I would highly recommend you do that. Okay,
sure.
Just set
okay.
up dual boot with Ubuntu and you can take it further. Okay. So I will also demonstrate how to set up Docker and all on Ubuntu once I understand the issue from others also, and then I will actually cover some other alternatives as well. Okay, as you have enough RAM on your system, you should try dual boot and you should be able to have some Docker containers using Ubuntu. You will not get the same experience as you get with Docker desktop, but still it is much better than using Windows.
Okay.
So who else have the problems apart from Janik?
Hi, sir. Manas this side. I tried it downloaded on Windows, but it didn't work because my version was 19.09 and they were asking for like 19.018 plus. So I tried to download the Ubuntu image so that I can use it through VMware. But after doing that, the machine was not starting. So I'm still facing the issue of running the Ubuntu on my Windows.
Yeah, even Ashish in the chat is asking or making a statement that we can use VMs as well, as, I guess. So he's actually asking the question whether we should be able to use VMs on Windows. So it all depends upon the configuration of your machine. So I think it is Venkat, right? Venkat Sai.
Hello. Yes, sir. I'm having the same problem as Ashish said.
Earlier it was Ashish. Who just asked the question earlier? Is it Venkat or someone else?
No, I'm Manas.
Yeah, Manas. So if you say that you set up Ubuntu, is it virtual machine or did you set up dual boot?
The virtual machine.
Okay. So it all depends upon the configuration of your machine. I do not recommend virtual machine route unless you have 16 GB RAM and i7. You need to have i7 quad core. Just having memory is not good enough. You need to have high-end CPU also. So I hope you guys understand the terms dual core, quad core, etc. So I think quad core became popular starting from i7. With i5, most of the systems are dual core. if you have i7 and quad core, which means you almost have 4 CPUs. So if you have more CPUs, you can run more process at the same time on your machine. So unless and until you have at least 16 GB RAM and i7 quad core, I do not recommend you to have virtual machine setup and then create Docker containers on it. If you have a lesser configuration than that, then I would highly recommend you to go with dual boot, have two operating systems. On boot, it will ask you whether you want to get into Ubuntu or Windows. If you want to practice these things, just get onto Ubuntu and start practice these things. That will be much more productive. And you can use Zoom and all to attend the live sessions. I think you can even set up Slack on Ubuntu, and you should be able to use all the features Windows provide as part of the Ubuntu as well. Unless or until for your college, if you have to use Windows for whatever reason, then probably you might face few challenges. They might not work with Ubuntu, but all standard tools and technologies which we are going to practice will work seamlessly on Ubuntu. So all those who have lesser configuration than 16 GB RAM, and also if your CPU is i5 dual core or i3 or whatever it is, i3 means you have to upgrade. To be frank, if you're still having i3 with 4 GB RAM, you need to upgrade your, you have to replace the laptop. If you have i5 and 4 GB, probably you can increase the memory to 8 GB, and you should be able to use it by leveraging some of the resources. If you have i7 quad core, then well and good, you should be able to use it to the fullest extent. Even if your memory is only 8 GB with i7 quad core, you can easily extend it to 16 GB, and you can leverage it for a lot more tasks. Okay, so depending upon your configuration, you have to decide the route. So I would highly recommend you to go with dual boot. If you don't want to go to dual boot for whatever reason, then there are a few alternatives which I would suggest. So let me open tab here. And
Hello, sir. This is Akshay here.
Yeah, Akshay, tell me.
Sir, actually, there is some article I found out that we can run on Windows also, this Docker. So I will just ping this git command, git config. So okay. It will like git to clone repository without adjusting line endings to for Unix to Windows. So I cannot like copy this image and paste it here, but I got it from that article only. Like,
okay, can you ping the link of the article in the Slack? I will review that.
Okay.
So yeah. Even if you are able to set up Docker, unless and until you have at least i5 and 8 GB RAM with at least dual core, the system will become slow once you start running Docker containers. Eventually, if you want to have Spark and other technologies set up on your machine, if you want to use your IDE, and if you have to run these Docker containers in parallel and all those things will become very slow. So i7 quad core is the ideal, i7 quad core with 16 GB RAM is the ideal configuration. Otherwise, you can practice these things up to an extent by having Docker container locally set up. But at some point or the other, you will start hitting the roadblocks. So I just want to cover what are the other alternatives in case if your system is becoming slow, so that because if your system becomes slow, your pace of learning will go down considerably. So there are free and cheap alternatives. I will just walk you through those alternatives, and then I will take it further. So if you want to have a server up and running all the time with a fixed cost, you can actually use this OVH.com. Our lab is also running on this platform, OVH.com. For the learning purpose, it is very good. Even if you have some production things running, if you are a startup, if you want to use it to deploy some of your applications, it is a good environment, at least to get started. And if you go here, there is a concept of dedicated servers. Okay, you can go to the dedicated servers, and you should be able to purchase the servers. Let me actually go here. So under servers, dedicated servers, you can actually choose these things, Rise servers, advanced servers, etc. Let's pick one of these. I have chosen Rise servers, and we can actually click on view prices. Okay, this is 32 GB RAM. Let's see if they have lesser configuration. So they don't have lesser configuration here. Let me see other ones. They used to have 16 GB configurations also. I'm just checking whether they have 16 GB configurations. View prices. Yeah, I think 16 GB ones are not there at this time. Dedicated servers. They have changed the interface recently. Yeah, see the full list of servers. Now I can actually try filtering for 16 GB. Oh, they became expensive. Earlier, there used to be servers for $32, $35. But I think now most of the 16 GB servers are gone. Are rented out. That's why you don't see too many options. So if you want to have a server up and running all the time, this is one of the cheaper options. However, you can use it as a backup towards the end of the thing, if at all it is required. I would highly recommend you to go to Google Cloud. Okay. So Google Cloud gives you $300 credit. And I have created some videos about how to use Google Cloud credit. Just search for it, you will get it. Otherwise, you let me know. I will try to get the information for you over our Slack channel. So in Google Cloud, you will get $300 credit, right? So even if you take 16 GB server, it will be pretty cheap. So let me actually take you to the Google Cloud calculator. You can also use AWS if you're already comfortable with it. But you will be charged except when you actually take the micro servers for 1 year. You will not be charged, but other servers will be charged in AWS, and it can be a bit expensive. You might end up spending like $40, $50 every month. As Google gives you $300 credit, you can see here. So let me actually stop this. If you look at this, right? Tools for modern applications. Start your free trial today. Focus on your product. High data security. Deploy in minutes. $300 free trial. It is available for 1 year. So within 1 year, you can actually saturate this $300. If you could not use this $300 within 1 year, then it will be gone. You have to pay if you want to use it. Okay, so still that option is there. So you can leverage this. Now you can actually go to the pricing. So when it comes to cloud, there are multiple things which you need to keep in mind. One is storage. Storage is fixed cost. Depending upon the amount of storage you rent, you have to pay based on that. Why it is taking this long? It shouldn't take this long. Yeah, let me use this. I think there is some issue with that server. How come? Internet speed is good. Then how come it is taking such a long time? I think there's a problem with Google itself. Google is slow a bit, I guess. Let's see if it comes up. Or it could be the issue with Google Cloud more than Google. Okay, sometimes if I go to Chrome, it might be faster. So let me open using Chrome. This is the problem with this Microsoft technologies, but I don't know why it is going to Yahoo. I think some homepage is updated. So Google Cloud pricing calculator. Yeah, this came up fast. I think Google might be deliberately restricting the speed of the traffic based on the browser, probably. So now you can actually enter the number of instances you want to use. It is enough to have one. What are these instances for learning? We will be using FreeOS only. And then you can actually choose the configuration here. So don't worry too much about series at this time. Just go to the machine type. And let's say you want to actually use 15 GB RAM and 4 vCPUs. If you choose this, and then you also need to add storage. Let us see what other options we have. It is saying local SSD. We don't need local SSD actually. There should be somewhere it will be talking about the storage. We will come back to that in a moment. And when it comes to cloud, you will be paying only based upon your usage. So for example, if you are practicing starting from 11 a.m. till 10 p.m., you can stop after 10 p.m. and you will be charged only from 11 a.m. to 10 p.m., which is approximately 11 hours. Okay, so you can actually say 11 hours here. Eleven hours per day, average days per week is 7. You can say add to estimate. Now you see, for that configuration, you are only paying $7.79 per 1 month. Okay, which is pretty cheap, and you can you have $300 credit. So this is one alternative. However, this is only for the VM which you will be provisioning from Google Cloud. And then you can actually scroll down. You need to include a few additional things. One is persistent disk. You need to have persistent disk so that you can bring down the VM whenever you stopped using it for that day, and you just want to start whenever you want it. Whether you use it or not, once you assign a persistent disk to the VM, you will be charged for it. It's a fixed cost for you. Okay, so in this, you can actually choose the cheapest option. You can spend some time in understanding and choose the cheapest option. For now, I'm actually saying standard provisioned space. I feel this is the cheaper one, but you can actually play around and figure out which one is the cheaper. And you can say add to estimate. Okay, and total estimated cost is $60 per month. So the cost is increased because of the storage, because we are trying to get 60 GB. Okay, but it is saying only USD $2.40. That means the earlier cost was not properly done. Means we didn't see the accurate number over there. So let me do this. Let me remove the storage for a moment. So let me scroll down, persistent disk. Okay, I think now it actually,
Is it because of number of CPUs?
No, that's fine. So in this case, $60 per month is also fine, but earlier I have seen $7.79 only. I don't know why it is increased to this price. Probably, go ahead.
I think it was 79 before.
On the top, you can see 5779.
Got it. Yeah, then I might have...
That is transient disk on the top.
No, let me finish.
No, thank you. It was 5779 before.
Yeah. So I might have overlooked that. I thought it was 779. I might have thought that 5 is a dollar. So that's why. I have 57. Thought, yeah, okay, then it is correct. So $57.79 for the server. And then $2.40 for hard drive, which is decent enough. You have $300 credit and you should be able to manage it for 5 months. And once you have this server, you can have at least 6 to 8 Docker containers running in it, lightweight Docker containers, and you should be able to use very effectively. You don't need to saturate the resources on your machine. So spend some time on this and try to understand the cost, but you have to be a bit careful once you start using the Google Cloud. If you forget and leave it up and running all the time, then you will be saturating the credits pretty fast. Second issue is, if you don't understand the concept of firewalls and to fix the issues in a dirty way, you might open up all the ports in the firewall. If you open up all the ports in the firewall, then the Bitcoin miners, they will try to hack these servers. And if they are able to get control of your servers, then they will saturate not only your credits. You might end up getting $2,000, $3,000 bill within 2 days. Okay? But don't be ever keeping that in mind. You just have to be a bit diligent when using the server. As long as you block all the ports, you are good to go. Okay. However, even if by accident, even if you end up running into issue, and if you get like $2,000, $3,000 credit, they will waive it off once without any questions. But they will not refund you the credits. Your credits will be gone. So that's the only side effect by accident if you forget to block all the ports and end up opening all the ports. If some blockchain miner end up hacking your system and use your system for huge data transfer, you might end up getting invoice for pretty high amount. You just have to be diligent about it. You also have to monitor your bill quite frequently and see how much you have in the credits and all, so that you have fair idea about what is going on. Okay, so that being said, let me actually demonstrate you a few of the important things which you need to keep in mind so that you start using this a bit more effectively. So here I'm going to Google Cloud Console. There are videos in the ITVersity channel itself about how to sign up for Google Cloud, how to start a VM. Initially, there will be some hiccups which you have to overcome. Once it is done, you should be able to use it. So for now, we'll be primarily using it for creating virtual machines and have Docker running in it. Now you can actually go to whatever account you have credits, okay? And then you can click on this. In this case, we are talking about virtual machines. Virtual machines are under Compute Engine. So you can go here and you can see the VM instances. So this is what we are interested in. And here you can create an instance. Once you understand the underlying costs, you can actually give some name to it. Data engineering. Okay, then the operating system is by default Debian. Let me see where it actually highlight. You can see here, and this is where the machine type is. So you can choose that 4 vCPU, 15 GB RAM. Okay, and the cost of $60 is if you use for 11 hours every day for 30 days. So it is for 330 hours. But if you use only for 150 hours, you will be charged only $35 to $40 because there's a fixed cost and variable cost. That fixed cost, $2, whatever it is for storage will be there. And then $30 probably for the virtual machine. So depending upon the usage, the credits will be saturated linearly, okay? That being said, when it comes to operating system, I would highly recommend you to use Ubuntu or CentOS 7. These two are good. So CentOS is this one. Ubuntu, sorry, not CoreOS, my bad. CentOS is this one. When it comes to CentOS, I would highly recommend to go for CentOS 7, neither CentOS 6, nor you should go with CentOS 8. It is still in early stages. CentOS 7 is one of the latest versions, which is pretty stable. I would highly recommend you to choose CentOS 7. So CentOS 7 is a Red Hat flavor. So when you actually try to troubleshoot issues, if you are not getting answers based on CentOS, you might get answers based on Red Hat, and you should be able to use most of them in CentOS. So either CentOS or you can also go for Ubuntu. When it comes to Ubuntu, I would highly recommend you to go for Ubuntu 18.04. Okay. And then you can actually choose the storage. Let's say you want to use 60 GB. standard persistent disk is good enough. We don't need to go for SSD. SSD will be a bit expensive compared to standard persistent disk. And then you can click on it. If you want to run some HTTP service on it, you can enable this. Only these ports will be enabled by default. Okay, but as part of this server, we will be primarily having the Docker containers. We will not be having any web service running on it. And hence, I'm not choosing these things. So you have to be very diligent on what each and every step you are taking here. You have to spend some time before you customize anything. If you are not customizing anything, then you can ignore for now. You don't need to break your head. But if you are trying to customize, you have to focus on certain things. And also to access certain services that are running on the system, you should know some of the key concepts. I will highlight those things once this server is up and running. So let me say create. Now the virtual machine is being created. Once the virtual machine is created, you will see SSH option here, and you should be able to configure SSH. This is where some of you might struggle. Let's discuss those things as part of the Slack channel. If you run into any issues, probably you can raise it in the Slack channel, and some of the friends might help you because some of them are pretty decent as per my observation. So they might be able to help you. If not, I will be there to help you. Okay. So it will just take a couple of minutes to come up. I think it is already up. To validate whether it is up and running or not, you can expand this. And you can actually open in browser window first. Then it will open up like this. And also, I would highly recommend for everyone to be very comfortable with SSH. SSH is the approach which we connect to the remote Linux servers. There is a concept of passwordless login also. I will demonstrate a few things today. But if you don't understand, make sure you understand those things. Already there are some videos in YouTube under my channel. You just search for it saying ITversity SSH passwordless. You will get some of the videos and you should be able to go through them. I think it is still coming up. That's why it is taking time to actually get inside. Let me close this and let me try once again. So to connect to these servers using SSH, you have to set up something called as gcloud. Okay, if you look at this, it is saying gcloud command, right? So there is something called as gcloud setup. You again Google around, you should be able to get the answers. In our channel also, we have some material around setting up gcloud. Once you set up gcloud, if you actually view this gcloud command, and then if you actually go to the terminal, so don't worry if you could not follow at this time, I will be there to support you. Okay, so if you run this command, what it will do is it will actually copy the keys onto the remote servers. So I think it is still not up, that's why it is failing. Let me see. I have this gcloud on this.
Sir, yeah. If we do this with Windows platform, I mean, like, yeah. If we go ahead with creating instance in GCP and accessing using our Windows, do we need to use PuTTY for this?
That is correct. Either you can use PuTTY or very good point. So if you are using Windows, there is something called as Git Bash. So you can set up something called as Git Bash. Yeah. And you should be able to use the SSH. I would highly recommend you to use the SSH for this.
Okay.
Okay. So PuTTY is a bit outdated. And as a data engineer, you should be comfortable with the SSH approach.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I think there is some issue with my gcloud. I think I know what is that. Okay. please verify that the following is the path to your working point 2.7 executable. As of now, my gcloud is configured with Python 2.7, but by default, my Python is 3.7.4. So that's why it is not working. Let me see. I think I have to upgrade. I will actually come back to this at a later point in time. But for you, you just follow the gcloud instructions. As the latest version will be pointing to Python 3, it will work without any issues directly. Once you run that gcloud command by expanding this, once you get this gcloud command and once you run this, it will make sure that it will copy the public key. It will establish the passwordless login between your machine and on the VM. So as of now, I already configure my system with the appropriate key that is being used here. And hence I can actually copy this public IP. This is called as public IP. So if you look at this, there is a copy icon. So I can click on this to copy. And then typically the key will be configured in this location. If you are using command line SSH, whether if you use git bash or sigwin on Windows, you can leverage the same command. If you are not familiar with git bash or sigwin, make sure you set those things up and then follow these instructions. It should work without any issues. If it doesn't work, I will be there to support you. Okay. You can also have something called as Ubuntu using Windows subsystem. Using Windows subsystem Ubuntu also, you should be able to run these SSH commands to connect to the remote machines. So there are multiple alternatives within Windows. You can try all these things. I will also ping these alternatives as part of the Slack channel after this session. Okay. So make sure you are able to connect to the remote servers using command line SSH like this, not by using tools like PuTTY. Okay, now I can say /.ssh, then Google Compute Engine. That is the key which is being copied when I actually provision first server using that account. And when I try to connect to the first server using that gcloud command. And then I should be able to say root at that public IP and hit enter. And then I can say yes. Oh, sorry, I think I should not use the root. I have to use my current user. Let me see what my current user is on this machine. It is ITVarsity. So I have to use the same username here. So the username should be ITVarsity here. Now I am inside the machine. Okay. So this is a Ubuntu based machine. You have tools to actually install softwares on Ubuntu. So if you want to install Docker on this Ubuntu-based machine, you just have to use one of the Ubuntu-based tool. So there is a typo here. It should be EERING, but that's fine. So typically in Ubuntu, we use apt. If it is CentOS 7, we use yum. Okay. So now we have to search for setting up Docker on Ubuntu. To be precise, 18.04. Okay. And then I can click on this. You can also directly install databases on it if you don't want to spend time on Docker. If you're already comfortable with Docker, if you don't want to waste your time on setting up Docker, yeah, you have 16 GB RAM and 4 cores. You should be able to set up MySQL database and all those things directly on it, and you can take it further. I will also explain why you have to do these exercises so that you have appropriate environment with full control as we proceed further. Just follow for now. You will understand the value of whatever we are doing as it evolves. Probably by next week, you will get some idea. Okay. Now you can scroll down, and these are the instructions. You just try following this. Sometimes because of the article which you got and the version of Ubuntu you have, there might be some discrepancies. You should be able to troubleshoot the issues and fix those things. Let's see if we will run into any issues. If at all we run into issues, I will try to fix those things. Okay. So the first command ran successfully, most likely that command will run successfully without any issues. So these are the some of the prerequisites which are required for setting up Docker. Then we are actually trying to integrate the Docker repositories with Ubuntu operating system. For that, we have to run these commands, curl command, and then sudo add apt repository. So by default, Ubuntu will be pointing to only the repositories related to common stuff on Ubuntu. Docker is not considered as one of the core item in Ubuntu. That's why you have to configure it as a third-party repository. And these two are the commands which are taking care of that. Now I should be able to run this. And this is also successful. Now we have to run this sudo apt update. You can also say hyphen y to not to get the prompt and directly install or upgrade without asking you to say yes or no. Now you should be able to run this. Finally, you have to run this. Once it is set up successfully, if you want to make sure that Docker has to be up and running on restart, you might have to enable. I think by default, it will be enabled. If it is not coming up automatically whenever you restart, you just say systemctl enable Docker. It will take care of enabling it, and it will be up and running on reboots. OK, now we just have to validate to ensure Docker is up and running without any issues. Now it is up and running. OK, now let us get that MySQL image. For that, we just have to say Docker pull MySQL. OK, it is saying permission denied. Probably we have to use sudo. So there is a way to avoid to enter sudo like this. You just have to figure out. For now, to keep it simple, I'll be using sudo for each and every command. You just have to make this user ITversity as a group, as part of a group where he can issue Docker commands directly. You can Google saying, how can I use Docker without sudoing if you don't want to use sudo like this every time you want to use Docker. Now the MySQL image is created. I can say, let me try Docker run first by saying hyphen hyphen name, MySQL underscore retail, hyphen D, and then hyphen E, MySQL root password equal to ITversity. Hyphen P, I'm taking care of port binding also here, 3306 colon 3306. Okay, and then the image, which is nothing but MySQL. Let's see what it says. It is saying permission denied. For now, I just have to use sudo. Once I say sudo, it will actually bring up the Docker container with MySQL database in it. Now it is started. I can say sudo docker ps. Okay, it is not running. So I just have to say hyphen A. It is exited. I just have to run the logs command to see why it is failing. Okay, MySQL root password. I think there is a typo in the MySQL root password. Yeah, D is missing in MySQL root password. That's why there is the error. So you see, I'm able to troubleshoot the issue by just running Docker logs. It is complaining you need to specify one of this. That at the time I realized that, okay, there could be typo while setting up the environment variable or configuring the environment variable. Now I took care of it. As the container was already created, I have to first delete it. Sudo docker rm MySQL underscore retail. Now I should be able to run it. Now it is up and running. there are a couple of folks on the attendee list. Let me make them panelists. Okay, now I can actually say Docker PS on this. It is up and running without any issues. Even the port binding is working. However, in this case, the server in which the MySQL is running is remote to us. Okay, even though the Docker container port 3306 is bound to the server, it is bound to whatever server I logged in at this time. You can actually get the details of this server by saying hostname hyphen f. So it is pointing to this server. And what is the IP address of that server? It is nothing but this one. Now, if I want to connect to MySQL database, I have to use this information, 35.202.102.229. To ensure whether I'm able to talk to MySQL or not, I can use the telnet command, paste this URL, and give the port number, which is nothing but 3306, to which the MySQL database that is running in the container is bound to on this server. Now you see it is not able to telnet. Why it is not able to telnet? You have to go to Google Cloud now. Now you need to understand how to open the port number to the external world so that someone can actually use the 3306 port to connect to the MySQL database that is running as part of the Docker container within the virtual machine we have created in G Cloud. For that, you can expand this and you can actually click on this view network details. Okay, and then you can actually go to firewall rules. Then you have to open the port number 3306 so that you can talk to that. So let's understand how to do that. So in this case, I have to add a new rule. To add a new rule, you can just click on create firewall rule here. You can give a name. So MySQL retail Docker. If you want to give description, you can give the description here. And then you are trying to get into that machine. Using port number 3306, and hence it is called as ingress. Ingress is nothing but inbound traffic. Egress is nothing but outbound traffic. Okay, and then you can leave these things as is. Specified target tags. Let's say all instances in the network. Source filter. So it is about source, from which source you want to connect to the database. In this case, I want to connect from everywhere. So I can say 0.0.0.0 like this. I think I have to say 0.0.0.0/0. You can also probably say, yeah, let's leave it at IP ranges for now. Now you have to enter the port number here. So you can select this and then you can say 3306. And then you can create this port number. What is saying? Make sure all field names must be lowercase letters, members, numbers, and hyphens. So I cannot have underscore. That's why it is failing. So let me replace these underscores with hyphens. And let me create. This step has to be taken care of whether you install MySQL directly on that virtual machine or through Docker. Because even if you install directly, it has to be running on a particular port and you have to make sure that you are able to listen to that port. Now I can run this and you can see it is actually able to listen on that port number. Now, if you have SQL Workbench set up, you can use SQL Workbench to connect to that. If you have MySQL client set up, I think I have MySQL client on my Mac. And hence I can say MySQL hyphen u. As of now, I don't have other user than root. I can say MySQL hyphen u root hyphen h. Host name is nothing but this one. We should be able to use the IP address. And then hyphen p, it will prompt for the password. 1 minute. Okay, I think I don't have the MySQL client installed on this. It is trying to connect to the server for some reason. Let me see. Yeah, That's why it is not working. Otherwise, it would have worked. If you have SQL Workbench, you can try to connect using SQL Workbench onto that database which is running in the Docker container. Now, using that, you should be able to do whatever you want. In case, if you want to mount the storage also, for example, if you want to set up the retail DB database in that, you can connect to the virtual machine. You can stop the container, docker stop mysql underscore retail, and then you can remove it. I'm also trying to remove here. Once you have removed, you can actually clone the repository. So most likely Git might be there already. So you see Git is already there. The GitHub repository for RetailDB data is nothing but github.com dgadraju/RetailDB. Okay. Now I can actually clone this by saying git clone. Now it is cloned. Now I can actually run that command sudo run. I also want to mount the storage by saying -v /home/itversity. I'm giving fully qualified path of the directory. It is nothing but /home/itversity/retail_db. And I want to mount it to /retail_db in the virtual machine. Now the virtual machine is created. I can validate by saying sudo docker exec-it mysql_retail ls- and hit enter. We can see the retail DB here. I can now connect by saying mysql -u root -p. It will prompt for the password. I can enter the password. Now I can create database retail, create user, retail_user, identified by whatever password you want. In this case, I'm using ITversity. And then grant all on retail_user.star retail.star. There seems to be some questions. I will take those questions once this is done. Just hold for a moment, okay? And then flush privileges. Now I can actually say use retail to connect to that database. Okay, now I can say source retail_db/retail_db/create_db.sql. That is the script we have in that folder, and hit enter. And now the tables and tables are created and data is being loaded into those tables. Now I should be able to say show tables to list the tables, and I should be able to run queries against the tables to see the data in the tables. So this is how you should be able to set up using the Google Cloud with $300 credit. You should be able to leverage that $300 credit to its best. This is the right time to leverage that and practice as much as you can with respect to these technologies that are relevant to be a data engineer. So that being said, I will come back to the questions now. So let us take the questions in sequence. Again, I mentioned yesterday, it is better to use Slack to ask the questions, because we'll have the track of all the questions, right? So we shouldn't miss some of these important questions. So going forward, please use Slack to ask any questions rather than Zoom chat, so that we have track of it. If at all I have to provide answer in written, I will be able to provide answer in written, and we should be able to have the complete log of whatever is happening. Okay, so the first question is, Kaushik have asked, does sudo elevate our permissions here? That is correct. I think someone already answered.
Sir, I have another question.
Sure.
Instead of installing MySQL using cloning Docker. The Git repository, using Docker and pulling the MySQL image, what if we can do it with LAMP stack? because that LAMP stack itself contains the MySQL, right?
Yeah, so you can do that, but it is not required. Unnecessarily, we'll be wasting the resources. LAMP will get you the
Linux, okay, you PHP, are saying,
yeah, so PHP will be there, yeah. Apache server will be running on it.
Yes.
So the purpose of creating this virtual machine is not just to run MySQL. Eventually, mm-hmm. we might run MongoDB in it. Probably we might okay. want to set Spark also in it to run Spark okay. job. So we will be using for different purposes.
Okay.
Okay. So that's why I just took the plain slate rather than taking some pre-configured images with LAMP okay. or what.
Okay. Okay. Got it.
Any other question before we wrap up? The session can be fast. You might feel it is a bit fast, but you just go through it once again. Make sure you pause wherever you are not understanding some of the key aspects. And at the same time, you should think and understand whether you should understand some of these aspects. If you feel it is not the time to understand, just move on. Just execute the steps and move on so that you see the progress on a regular basis. Okay, I thought of covering normalization also today, but I realized that if I have to demo everything about the alternatives to set up the environment to unblock you, to have a proper environment for practice, I feel that I should spend some time on this gcloud. That's why I changed the agenda in the last minute. I will try to cover normalization day after tomorrow. Tomorrow we might not have the session, but if there are questions and if there are some important questions and if I have to answer them over the call, I will try to set up that session and I will try to answer. Otherwise, we'll catch up day after tomorrow. Okay. So if anyone joined for the first time, so make sure you attend these sessions on a regular basis. If I sometimes some people might ask question and it might not be relevant for everyone. I will highlight that as part of the Slack and you just follow the Slack and you decide whether to join the session or not. Attendance is mandatory for some of the sessions. I will highlight that. So whenever I say that you should attend the session, make sure you attend that session. And I will give you a heads up. I will not inform you in the last minute the way I have done today. I will at least give a day or two a heads up so that you are prepared to attend these sessions. If you cannot attend the sessions, just let me know that this time I will not be able to attend the session. I will go to the backup. That will actually show the commitment and I will try to make sure that I take it as an exception and I will let you be part of the batch. But if you are not taking it seriously, just to move out of the Slack channel, there is no point in be part of this. It's unnecessary overhead for you. If you are serious, make sure you follow these things. Even if you don't understand today, you will understand the relevance of these things as you proceed further. And then definitely it will add value. And if you attend the session for the first time, I'll be sharing the playlist where these videos are. Make sure you attend yesterday's session also. Then you will understand some of the, you will understand the relevance of whatever I spoke today. Okay. If you directly attend the today's session, then you might not understand it completely. Just go back to the previous session and just scan it through in some places and you should be able to relate it to what I have covered as part of today's session. There is nothing, okay. Prasad, Slack invite is expired. Prasad, can you actually ping your email as part of the Zoom chat? Just ping it to me. I will send the invitation once again. Okay. Anyone else who have to join the Slack? So I'm still accepting people for this batch. So if you have your friends who are graduating between May and August, just let me know. I will include them also. Prasad, it is saying this person is already in your workspace. I don't know how to resend. Probably you might have clicked already and joined, or I don't know. Let me see how I can resend it to you. Okay, I have to figure out. Yeah. So that being said, that's it for today. We'll catch up as part of the next session. Be active in the Slack. If you run into any issues, just ping in the Slack. I am glad that people are responding to those queries. Help each other. It will definitely pay us in the longer term. Okay. Thank you. Bye.